And we're back. We now have to try to resolve a disagreement between these two, Andronus and Raima. At the bequest of Idiris. By the looks Raima and Andronus turn your way, you've interrupted a promising tangent of their apparently infinite argument. Idiris asked me to mediate your dispute. They react like, exactly like, sullen children. Andronus folds his arms and turns away from you. Raima flushes and stares at her feet. All right, Raima mutters at last. Tell us what you need to know. Something else first? There's nothing else to say. They wait for you to speak in silence, arms folded and locked. First, what exactly are you arguing about? The two watch each other warily for a moment, as if speaking first will somehow forfeit the argument. We mostly disagree, Andronus says at last, on the amount of respect due our sire. He arches a cold eyebrow at Raima, a simple question. She gives a reluctant nod. Let's hear your side, Raima. It's simple, sister. The endless battle is a test, and Andronus' side has been failing it for centuries. Our creator managed to annoy the first enough that she stormed off in a huff. He even did it in Andronus' body. You'd think that this big oaf of all people would understand what our sire was thinking. She shakes her head, laughing. The fact of the matter is our father created this sanctuary for us to protect us from the sorrow. But hiding isn't a strategy. Eventually, we have to take the battle to it. The gleam in her eyes is a banked fire. And when that time comes, our father wants an army who will follow his orders without question. He allowed the first to spread her doubts, and the traitors among us have flocked to her side. She tosses Andronus a scornful look. Even so, I'm sure it hurt our father to discover that so many of his children mistrusted him. She says, lowering her eyes. Imagine how that feels, knowing that you'd have to kill some of your children to save the rest. And that's it, she says with an elegant shrug. Simple, like I said. Andronus simply can't accept that his grand rebellion is all part of our father's plan. Can't accept that we owe our existence an ongoing survival to him. She sneers at Andronus. If you hate his sanctuary so much, why not leave? She thinks, and he wants us to kill each other over it? Better to spend our lives in the war itself. I think our father made a greater sacrifice than we know. Divided, we don't stand a chance against the sorrow. He let the first rebel so that we could deal with the traitors among us before that final battle. Tell me what's troubling you, Andronus. I just don't understand her, he says, flinging his hand in Raima's direction. The changing god abandoned us at birth, then fed us lie after lie when he chose to speak with us at all. She claims he has a master plan. I see a man who served himself, first and always. He doesn't care if we die. Even I care more if Raima dies than our sire does. He thinks, siblings? Ha! Sharing that bastard's consciousness does not make us related. He barks a bitter laugh. Did you know that he sparked the whole war from my body? He got the first angry at me, then ditched his cell, leaving me to deal with the consequences. Good thing the first knows the difference between the face and the mind. He rubs his eyes. But Raima, look, I know how she feels. The sorrow is hunting all of us. It's nice to think that the changing god has a plan to protect us. It's just not true. I know. He glares at Raima, then looks back at you. Damn it, he says, turning away. After a moment, you see why. There are tears in his eyes. None of us want to kill each other. You see that, right? His eyes harden. But if I have to choose between someone brave enough to stand against our father and her, I'd drop her and mourn later. The changing god has turned us on each other. And for what? To draw the sorrow's eye away from him? For fun? He growls under his breath. Raima wants to believe his intentions are noble, but she's fooling herself. Hmm. Before I make any decision, what sort of solution would satisfy you both? Indigo Tide? Neither of them speak for a moment. Their faces are identical sculptures of surprise. I don't know, Andronus says, glancing at Raima. Nothing you could say would make us take each other's side. And with apologies to Adaris, I don't want to get along with Raima. I've hated her for too long. No offense. Raima's lip quirks. Honesty doesn't offend me. She looks over at you. And we need a decision. You can't please both of us. Our points of view aren't ever going to line up. Your argument is based on the endless battle, isn't it? Is that why the battle's still going on?
Making a note.
Yes. He huffs and casts a dark look at Raima. Whenever our father has the chance, he spends our lives like a loose handful of shins. We keep fighting to stop him. He grins mercilessly. To tear him down.
I'll remember that.
You idiot, Raima says, but without real rancor. Okay, maybe I sounded rancor. Our father never makes a move without knowing he's going to win. We're stronger than you, and we have right on our side. You're going to lose this war down to the last soldier, then you'll see that I'm right. The only way to convince the other is to show the other what the truth is. You know, and Andronus was there. He might be, you know, truthful. That might be the truth. But does Raima even believe him? And he's observing the argument. I've heard your arguments. I'm ready to resolve your dispute. Andronus and Raima go still and stoic, showing no sign of the emotion they displayed before. In this moment, they look very much alike, like family. Okay, so we can tell both of them to leave Milavast. I can tell Andronus to leave. I can tell Raima to leave. Or I can say neither of them is right. Or I can ask this question. Or I can say this question. Do you really want to break the truth, the truce, to kill each other over a point of view?
I'll remember that.
Ooh, gold and indigo. Andronus opens his mouth, shuts it thoughtfully. Finally, he speaks. You're right. We're safe here, but the sorrow is circling, if the rumors are true. I don't want to do its work. All right, Raima says, letting out a ragged breath. Just let's talk about something else, Andronus. Can we do that? For now, gladly. We settled this the right way. At least, what we think is the right way. The two castoffs stand together, murmuring to each other. Both nod at you. Nice to see you two getting along. Your older siblings roll their eyes in unison. Are you still getting along? They eye you warily, then continue their murmured discussion. So either way, they go back to ignoring us like they were before.
I'm ready.
Okay, so let's return to Adaris, whose name I keep forgetting. Have you helped Raima and Andronus come to a conclusion yet? I managed to persuade them to their senses. They've agreed to a temporary peace. She claps her hands softly. Well done. Well done indeed. Or maybe a few claps. To be free to choose is part of life in Milavast. We must own our choices, just as we own our responsibilities for the outcomes of those choices.
Updated my journal.
It was like when she says that. Before I can allow you to alter the course of a brother's life, I would hear your opinion on something which touches the lives of all our kind. You have no doubt heard of the endless battle, but what do you know about it? Why did they fight? And who is right? She bows her head slightly. If, perchance, you have heard only a little about the conflict, you may wish to speak to your brethren before answering. Let's see if any more questions first. I would hear your opinion on the endless battle. You may speak to others first if you wish to learn more before we discuss it. So what do you believe the point of the endless battle is? Well, this is true. This is also true. Might be none of my business. The point is for each side to prove the rightness of their position. Thalana and her men. Or what Barakal said. The endless battle makes us stronger through conflict. Well, that's that other one we met when we first went on top. In the Valley of Dead Heroes. Well, these all can all be perceived as being right. This is all opinion. I want to stay neutral on it, pretty much. This is definitely not neutral. Well, actually, no. The goal is to stay atop the Changing God. That's not neutral. This is true. That's true also, but very, very generalized, I think. This is an opinion also against to the other side. Like any war, each side is trying to achieve its goals through force. Yes, but what are those goals? And why are they so important that neither side has conceded defeat in all these years? It's war. Senseless violence caused by pride. Not all wars are senseless. Sometimes war is the only means by which a group may achieve its goals. He just argues with every answer I give. What else do I agree with? The point is for each side to prove the rightness of their position. Does strength prove truth? Does murder provide justice? There is merit in changing your opinion when presented with rebuttal. Only be certain that, in doing so, you do not abandon the truth. She spreads her hands in conciliation. But you must forgive me. The point of this exercise is not to frustrate you, rather something else entirely. She clasps her hands together. So, why do you think I've asked you this? No. Let us start from the first task. Why would I tell you to talk to Melmoth when he ridicules my beliefs? Expose me to other viewpoints. You wanted to expose me to other viewpoints. Precisely. When we have incomplete information and are exposed to alternate, opposed viewpoints, how do we judge which is true? We must reach a conclusion at some point, but unless those conclusions are backed with incontrovertible evidence, you must never imagine that you have the sole grasp on the truth. And what do you imagine I intended when I asked you to intervene with Raima and Andronus? Could be either of these. To resolve a dispute with regard for both parties' feelings and motivations. That is exactly so. My intention for you in this task was to have you change the lives of your siblings for the better, while they still control their own bodies. To offer them alternatives and see if you can provide them a route through their troubles that maintains their core goals. Then we come to the question of the endless battle. What purpose did that discussion serve? Huh. challenging my beliefs with alternate viewpoints, perhaps. Correct, and astutely judged. The goal in all of this was to make you question your assumptions, to see things through others' eyes. She holds your gaze. It may be that nothing of import happens in Zarian's mirror. You might enter, speak with Mazov, and leave without altering him a bit. But even if so, there will be other mirrors. What if the next one is Melmoth's, or Raima's, or even mine? Whose assumptions will you take with you into that life? Whose goals will you accomplish, and at what cost? You have the power to change the course of a life, of many lives. Without their permission, or even their knowledge, you will have to weigh their desires against your own, deciding whether the needs of your life are more important than theirs. You will have to know, with the utmost certainty and integrity, what does one life matter? There's the tagline, guys. Seek your own answer, sister. That is what matters most. She thinks. What does one life matter? I like this. I like this. Yeah, kinda. So many choices. You're not dead until you're forgotten. Nah. I like this one. One life can find new knowledge, making new discoveries, passing along knowledge, making humanity greater. That's the purpose. Is it really the purpose of life? You know, I don't know. That's like Melmoth's. That's Melmoth's answer. Is that what life is, to benefit others? I mean, as far as life benefiting others, that's the answer for this. And this. This says it doesn't matter. Benefit others. Use your life constructively. I think this. It matters only as much as we let it matter. We make our own meaning, our own truths. Silvertide, huh? This matches my personal experience as well. We have meaning where we find meaning, chaos where we lack it. Yet, you would do well to examine this belief.
Making a note.
From within her robes, she produces a small, clean box. A stylized version of the Changing God's sigil is emblazoned across the top of it. This is the mirror caster of a cast-off named Zarian. One brother looked into it once and reported seeing Zarian in the fields of Asafagan and later speaking with Mazov. I highly recommend you take care of any unfinished business before you enter the mirror. You can change the past, after all. Anything might happen. Let me know when you are ready. Take care of unfinished business. So we do have a few things to take care of before we return here. Okay. So unfinished business. I'm thinking before we do this. Get rid of the sorrow fragment. Oh, should we really take care of the endless gate first? Phoenix's horror, severed child, and the lost shepherd. I don't know who can help him. If it's not somebody,
allow me,
in the Valley of Dead Heroes, then he's not going to find help just yet. Because even if I knew how to get back to Sega's Cliffs, I don't want to run all the way back there. I wonder if we can use these at some point.
Fine.
So yeah, I'm returning to the, Valley of Dead Heroes.
Ready.
Right now. Gonna wrap up some more quests. Press the center hexagonal button. Hexagonal? Because that's how we get back. Hello there. These guys are around here now. Don't they have anything new to say? Gnar of the Blessed. Alright. Good riddance. Utwag. I found a tomb below for a girl named Choi Cai'sul. Do you know anything about her? Cai'sul? Well, I don't know anything about her, but you might ask my colleague, Ronos Cai'sul. He should be in the valley somewhere, if the cultists haven't killed him, that is. Seemed like you care a lot. So I definitely wouldn't... Yeah, this is where we can rest for free. No charge. So I'd definitely run back and rest here. You know, before, you know, rather than, you know, rest where we were in Mila Vest. Farewell, friend and savior. Jenkins! Okay, that's it. Okay, work our way back.
On my way.
We need to visit Ronos and Phoenix. Tantalum. We'll probably have a option to ask him about something, the people we've encountered. I've read about 23 tombs, have I? Great! Keep searching. You're sure to find the answers you seek. He smiles gently. I met Silver. He said he knew you. Ah! And how is that delightful creature? How has it been doing on its particular task? What is Silver? What kind of creature? A human, I suspect, though in a strange shape. He smiles to himself. A strange shape, indeed. A human, probably. What answer is Silver looking for? Oh, that's for him to decide. But I imagine it's not an answer he seeks. More like he's seeking himself. Or itself, if you prefer. I met a man named Hero. He said that you're a fraud. Did he? That's a pity. I was going to mention him to you and tell you not to follow his path. He leans in closer. Hero's not dedicated. He doesn't have the ability to stay the course. I'm sure you will, though. Okay. I don't suppose anything new with this. The box filled with gods.
Let's go.
Yeah, Aratus's mystery. Okay, let's talk to Phoenix about the message we found from another version of him. Oh, you're back. He seems slightly surprised. I found your marker in the necropolis. The note contains a code to your tomb.
I'll remember that.
He takes the note from you, scrutinizing it intently. He shimmers and flickers momentarily, and then exerts himself to remain material through a force of visible will. That would explain why I could not understand myself. An artificial construct in my mind. I am dead and manifest again. Have I mastered time? He takes an internal inventory. No, I am a particular shade, a remnant, an echo of what could have been. I shall fade, then, and hope that my lesson remains.
Listen to me, dear. I must tell you something.
Okay, sweetie, hold on. I thank you. Knowledge is precious. Treasure yours. And now I will rest. Farewell. With a flicker of light, the yawning of a consciousness roused and returning to oblivion, he flickers away into the air. A faint hiss is the only marker of his passage. Really? So he made himself, like, de-exist? What? I've answered all of Adiris's questions, and she will finally allow me to use the Mirrorcaster and speak to Mazov. She pointed out that changing the past could means anything could change, so I should prepare myself and tell her when I'm ready. Hopefully this will all be over soon. So completed. I told Phoenix I had found his tomb. He is a smaller part of the true Phoenix. Once he knew that, he faded away, perhaps returning to his true self. Oh, okay. So I need to go back there. And see if he's still there, like whole, you know? Or if he's, you know, left. Gone on to greater things. Well, that was interesting. And Callus Tees wants to talk to us.
That man, Phoenix. Was it simply the missing knowledge of his own death that drew him back to life? Or do you think it was something more?
What do you think he was looking for? She is silent for several moments. Eventually she sighs. I don't know. It seems he was only able to wait for the right person to help him. What a pitiable existence. I would think by myself for a while, if that's all right with you. Huh. Okay.
Yes, now. I'm going.
Just want to see if we can get anything else from these other... I need to talk to him, too. Yeah.
Yes, child.
I don't suppose these guys have anything to say.
Yes, child.
Stay out of our way.
Coming,
dear. Yeah, let's go talk to Ronos here.
Naturally.
Ready.
Are those bell checks, are there anything new to say? Have you taken care of the cultists? The longer it takes, the more I fear for all of us. He puts his hand across his eyes. I'm sorry. I shouldn't rush you. How can I help you? I found a tomb for a girl named Choi Cai'sul. Is she any relation to you? Choi Cai'sul? How interesting. No, sadly, I've never heard the name. I took my name not from Choi's marker, but from the hero I was in my true life, Ronos Cai'sul. Here. Let me give you the code to that tomb so that you can write it yourself. You can visit it yourself. I'm thinking about writing it. He clears his throat. Maybe Choi's name is in the histories. If you can access them, that is.
Updated my journal.
He scribbles numbers on a scrap of cloth and hands it to you. 2413. Okay, so 2413. Ronos's tomb. Okay. Farewell.
Let's go.
Okay. So I have an idea. Maybe if we visit these people,
all right,
they'll be able to help Eritus. Let's check in with Persea really quick. Who just mutters? Okay.
I'm going.
Lana. Nope. Huh. I've learned that there is another Cai'sul enshrined in the necropolis. Perhaps there's some relation to the girl Choi. The tomb code, blah blah blah. Okay, guys. Thanks so much for watching. Next time... Yeah, what else do we have? We're going to Ronos Cai'sul's next episode. I do need to do this, though, which means I have to die. But I know how to do that. An Eritus, a doctor. You know, if we've come across one. So that's it. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode when we visit Ronos Cai'sul's tomb and endure. In enduring, grow strong.